So the vlogs over the last week have been a series of false projections. I'm gonna turn the machine back on. I'm done now, but I'll finally get to it, and etc. And it just kept dragging on. It's 5 o'clock in the morning on Sunday the 26th. I've been up for a few hours. I actually am for real caught up on everything. I have the vlog for tomorrow night uploading. The vlogs for the next 2 days are much shorter, so they'll come through much quicker. I've got my rating all caught up, and everything else. So, I am positioned to finally get started on this. We're finally get back to this. I'm just gonna get something to eat, and then I'll get the machine back on. So when am I gonna start the gear updates? The gear updates will start today. I'm gonna get the machine back on, meaning it'll be this week, and I'll get the first piece of gear back in next week. I'm presuming that the electrical works itself out. Again, I need to point out that the air conditioner is just ridiculous. It sounds like somebody's running a generator upstairs. It's just absurd, right? So it's just like, woof. I get the feeling that turning the computer on itself might cut the circuit a little bit, and that might be one of the best things I could do. I mean, besides the heat that the machine throws off, just having the machine on might reduce the amount of electricity that he's able to draw, right? If that's the case, I'm going to extend that logic further, right? But I need to watch my machine go too, right? I don't want any hard crashes or anything. This is, of course, it's not ideal, right? Like, the ideal would be just to turn off your fucking air conditioner, right? But that's not gonna happen, so I gotta figure out how I'm gonna deal with this. Like I say, for now, I don't think I'm gonna have a full meal. I'm just gonna finish my meal from yesterday. I'll figure that out, as I go, and then get the machine on, play around with some things, do at least one good full listen, and then eat around noon. That's my plan, I think. But I don't see any unexpected drawbacks. I thought I changed the batteries in this. Okay. I don't see any unexpected drawbacks. No Brexit. No, no vlog catch-ups to slow me down. Like, here. One of the things that slowed me down the other day was writing up the Joy Formidable show. Right? And then, you know, I had to copy over all the comments, like, nothing like that. I'm back to what I'm doing, and I'm gonna do it. So they're talking about, assisted suicide. Again, this is an old video, it's from 2014, before the recent ruling and, new legislation that I've talked about a few times. I just want to, They're having a big debate about what level of public support there is for a doctor-assisted suicide. You know, they have this one panelist that's saying that, you know, it's across the spectrum. Every identifiable demographic has over 85%. And this person here is working for a union of palliative care nurses, and she's saying that most of the people that work for her oppose it. And this is irrelevant, okay? Individual rights are not determined by consensus. They're rights. And so it doesn't matter what the broader public's opinion of it is. It matters whether or not there's an infringement on somebody's autonomous decision-making. If we had a referendum on smoking and it passed, does that mean that it would be right to ban smoking? Now, what we're talking about here is we're talking about taking away rights, right? Or if we had a referendum on slavery in the Deep South, you can be pretty sure it would have passed, right? And so does the fact that most Southerners supported slavery, does that mean that slavery is okay? And I mean, I'm okay with drawing comparisons on that level, you know, and if you want to, you know, yell and scream and, you know, put steam out your ears and, you know, then you can go ahead and do that. It's not really too much concern to me. But it's the wrong question. Individual rights are not to be determined by a democracy. That's called the tyranny of the majority. And it's a little bit ironic that we have what is essentially a conservative news source having this debate without any real conscious awareness of it. My opinion of the legal of what I think should be legal with physician-assisted dying or euthanasia or whatever you want to call it, whether there's 10% support for it or 95% support for it, should make no difference on what the law says and on what the court rules. We make collective decisions about how we use resources together. We don't make collective decisions about, you know, what people's morals are. We don't legislate morality. We're a liberal democracy. We're not a theocracy. That was a brain freeze. I should have saw that coming. I just didn't think to change them. Anyways, so yeah, this is meaningless. Nobody cares what public, or no, nobody should care what public support is. You know, it's like nobody should care what public support for abortion is, because it's an individual's right? It's a personal choice. Nobody should care what public support for gay marriage is, or public perceptions of homosexuality. Nobody should care what public support for transgender access to bathrooms is. These are not discussions to be had in the public sphere. These are issues of individual rights. I was going to wait for this until I did my next batch of cleaning, but it's getting a little bit unwieldy, so let's throw some things in the garbage. First off, I have, I believe that this is six cheese wrappers. Well, it's been a while. But I told you when I started this that it's basically going to be a bag full of cheese wrappers. And it's turning out that way. And similarly, this is some fettuccine. Maybe I should actually have a second thought about this. Well, I guess at the end of the day, whether I throw a bagel bags, and the bagel bags do eventually get thrown out or throw this, it doesn't really make a lot of difference, does it? I spilled some coffee like 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago. There's that. You know, I don't know if I can recycle that or not. I'm choosing not to out of carefulness, but I probably could. This is produce bags for tomatoes and green peppers, things of the sort. So that's another thing, is the green peppers. I don't buy more green peppers anymore, bags. Maybe I can find some kind of way, get some kind of reusable plastic bag or something. This is a little bit of spaghetti that found its way around. And some tape, I think probably for the Dread Formidable show, but don't quote me on that. Whole bunch of stickers of bananas and tomatoes. Green peppers don't have stickers. I did open a new hot sauce some point in the last month. There's a sticker in there too. It's the inside of a Kleenex box. That's the plastic wrapper for the straw for the big gulp. And I guess I got some scattered things here. Extra stickers, that's bag shit, etc. How's it doing? It's still, that was actually a relatively, that was like a month, right? So, again, like, if that's the sum total of garbage I threw out all month, This is the same bag from the beginning of January. It's now July. If I can get a year in, I think I've made my point, and I think I probably can. Even with all the real bags and the unnecessary increase in plastic that's possibly a consequence of the shift back to spaghetti. Let me think about this. I mean, look, I can still fit all my textbooks in. I guess it'll be a milestone when I have to take one of my textbooks out. But I think it's a good ways before I get there. Considering that with the textbook, it's down to about here. So that actually is, you know. But I mean, it's not like it's. That's still pretty loose. Although it's starting to feel more like a garbage bag, huh? Yeah. But I mean, it's still like that's pushing all the way down. There's lots. I think I'm a third of the way there. Right, so that's what? 5 months? 5.5 months? If 6 months is a full third, then 18 months. Can I get to, let's get to 1 year first before we start talking about 2 years here. One thing at a time. Still no pants, need to be careful with that. It's what, 8 o'clock? Yeah. We're finally getting a nice 40 degree day. This is the first 40 degree day of the year. 40 degrees with humidity, that is. It's only gonna be 30. You know, the way that the weather network, or the media, the weather people, the way they you know, play things up there, they're calling for an extreme heat warning. Like the overnight lows are like below 20, right? I think they had an extreme heat warning ahead yesterday, and it was like 15 degrees until noon. Okay, it's just all media hype, right? I mean, if you actually read the forecast is, you know, relatively accurate, right? They're not perfect, but they're within a very close margin of error, right? But the whole rigmarole they put around it, you know, with extreme weather warnings and, you know, severe heat effect, like it's all a bunch of nonsense, right? Yesterday in their supposed severe heat, if I would have looked at the weather, and I would have looked at the thermostat, and I would have looked at the temperature, I would have said it's cold out, and yet it's a severe heat event, right? Ridiculous. I remember, again, I haven't been in Windsor that long, but I remember summers in Ottawa. Ottawa's not that far from here, but it is further north. And, you know, on average, you're looking at maybe a 3 or 4 degree difference over the course of a year. Sometimes it'll be hotter in Ottawa for a day or two just because of the way the system's, you know. So if you have a hot front and the hot front comes through Windsor at 10 o'clock in the morning and hits Ottawa at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, then the humidity will be higher there, so it'll be hotter, right? It's just the nature of living here, you know, beyond a heat front. Sometimes it's, you know, with so much of the weather determined by air masses moving north, sometimes you actually get warmer as you move further north, right? But broadly speaking, it's about, you know, 2 or 3 degrees warmer here. And I remember summers in Ottawa where it was like weeks of 35 degree weather, you know, 2 weeks straight of 35 degree weather. It's been the last couple of summers have been cold, right? I think anybody in the eastern part of North America will agree that we haven't really had much of a summer for the last 2 or 3 years in a row. I think it has to do with it's a whole decrease in solar output thing, right? That's we're not going to go to don't get me wrong here. I'm not, you know, arguing that we're heading to an ice age and global warming is a mistake or any of that nonsense, right? I think the statistical evidence for global warming is pretty solid. But the solar increases and the solar output is happening independent of our emission of carbon. And hence, they will have independent outcomes, right? You will have independent outcomes from independent variables, right? That's not a technical discussion, really. The point being that, I mean, I think that you can, and this is, there's a long-standing correlation that when the sun cycle goes down, in this particular part of the world, in this particular part of North America, what happens is you get these wavy jet streams, and, you know, it gets warmer, it's been very warm out west, right, because that's where the jet stream is peaking from, and then the jet stream comes down over where we are, we end up, you know, near it or under it, and we get crappy summers, right, so... Like, the Meteorology Agency in Canada is calling for an extreme heat event. This is, for me, this is like the first summer that we've had all year. And the first, you know, like, we've had very little of it for the last several years, right? So I'm actually excited to get the windows open and actually experience summer for the year. We might not get a lot of it. It is supposed to be warmer, and it has been a little warmer. In bunches, right? So we'll get like two or three like almost summer days around 30 degrees, and then like, you know, a bunch of days in, you know, in the mid 20s, right? If it's not 30, it ain't summer. That's my my perspective, right? If the guy upstairs is listening to me, he's probably having a heart attack, right? Anyways, that means I've got, we're getting a nice 35 degree day, 40 degree humidity, so hopefully we can flush some of that in, get some heat in here to fight the air conditioner upstairs. So we got all the windows open. Let's hope the heat comes in early and stays light. And let's hope we don't get too much rain, because that's what it looks like is going to happen. Other thing is that, how do you like that, huh? The machine's coming on. I've got some filing to do before I start listening, but that's the task for this afternoon. Let's give it a good listen, and then I'll get something to eat, and then I'll come back. All right. Yeah, see, I'm wanting to. I'm wanting to be building this like right away, kind of thing, right? But like, even something as simple as determining what numbers I'm using for each period is undetermined until I get there, kind of thing. So what I'm going to need to do is, if I want to do this, I mean, this has to be done by the time I'm, like, it has to be done by the time I finish each disc in the period. I don't know if we went through this in the vlog or not, but the records will close 20 minutes. Sorry, 20 years afterwards. And I just don't remember if we had this talk or not. If we didn't, it's up in the blog, the music blog. There's the Music of Jessica Maria Blogspot. We talked about it there. Or I talked about it there. The records are going to have to close 20 years after the early state, because I want them to have documents in them that won't be done until then. Right, like the alter reality has to complete before I can close the record, because that will go into the liner notes. As you know, each of these releases are gonna have like little booklets, and like these are gonna be like in some cases like 50, 60 page books. when I get to some of the lighter ones, I could be looking at the epic novels of just journals, right? It's just, I want to include the journal because it's a big part of it, right? Like what I was thinking when I was doing it. And because like some of these have three or four phases of construction to it, you know? But I mean, like this is final. This is the summer of final reconstruction. So this has to be kind of done but it doesn't make sense to be. I keep doing this, right? I keep expanding the logic, but it's got to be the end of it. What else would there be to do? I mean, I suppose eventually I will get to the point in the alter reality where I'm narrating this, right? But then, I mean, I can't. I mean, I have to put it like on autopilot when I get there, right? So, like 20 years from now, the alter reality will be in 2016, right? And so it'll be 2036, and I'll be trying to. I mean, it's gonna have to get to the point where it's like we've already done this. But I mean, who knows? By then, maybe we'll be dealing with virtual reality or something. Who knows? And then I'll look back on this vlog and I'll say I'm 20 years ahead of my time because I predicted that we were dealing with. I've already done this once before, right? The vlogging of the future will be like multidimensional, right? It's because it was raining just ever so slightly. It was a nice night. And, oh, sorry, it was snowing. It was just barely snowing. That's what it was. And the best way to vlog the snow would be for me to find a way for you to experience the snow, right? And it'll happen one day, right? I'll be able to, like, you know, like suck down space in 8 dimensions and send it to a virtual reality camera. Probably not in 20 years. We need breakthroughs in physics before we can, like, forget about the computing, you know? Forget about the complexity. We don't understand space well enough. We could find a way to describe it, but there'd have to be a programming step in between, right? To actually transmit it would be, you know, very, very difficult. Anyways, yeah. So what I want to do is I want to sit down and, you know, take some of the alter reality posts I've already made, put it together, and just kind of build it as I'm developing, right? But the truth is that that doesn't make any sense. Instead, what I'll have to do is I'll have to. Well, it doesn't make any sense right now, right? It might make sense a month or two from now, right? So yeah. That's what I'm gonna have to do. I'm gonna have to put aside the alter reality for now, and then I'll come back to it. And then I'll come back to it once I'm done, period one, in the musical component, right? Which is what I was doing in the first place, right? So I mean, I can't. This won't be an issue for period two, but I don't think, because I don't think I'm going to be adding releases, right? I'll just be putting through. It's just because there's this big space in the middle where I created singles and I remixed things, and as mentioned, I'm going to have to put that back, right? So I still have, what, one, two, three, well, at least three singles, probably more than that. And then the full record, along with the compilations that I've updated. Yeah, and then the compilation of that. Doesn't Reclaim to still make sense? Take a look at that. Kind of doesn't, because it's all just like every single one of these songs is. I suppose it does in the sense that it's a there's no filler, right? I'm sure I wrote this down somewhere and I came to a conclusion already. Doesn't mean it's permanent. Anyways, and that's just period 1.2, right? So it's the first 20. Maybe, right? I may even add more into that. So, down and listen. And go from there. Okay, so. No compiling right now, just listening. Alright, okay. Let's go. So the record is at least closed, but I haven't been able to listen to it all the way through yet. I am still getting interference. It's the same basic issue. There's some kind of like electricity in the air or a signal or field or something. I don't think it's a short. I think it's just, you know, like I think it's the space, right? So and I have another sort of annoyance that's popped up, and it's going to occupy me probably for the rest of the day. I just realized going through that Facebook has put an entirely different class of information into my activity log that I will need to remove to archive. So I'm going to stop what I'm doing for I don't know how long to take that out. So that's my new focus for the next little bit. Let's get this done first. Not because I want to, but because I have to. I think I'm probably just going to delete a lot of it, but I mean, I don't want all this shit on my Facebook page, right? Like, I was going through and I realized, like it's cluttering up the feed. So it's like, the whole point was to clear it off so that I can get what I want, and now I got all this shit that's cluttering it up. So I gotta remove all that, right? So, it's the next thing to do. And we'll go from there. So about 5 o'clock at night, and the weather in here is finally gorgeous. 29 degrees. I don't know if you can see that or not, but I think this is the first time, like, all year that I've had the heat in this room off. Because I guess this is where he's got the air conditioner the strongest is in here, so, like, even when it's been, like, I can get the air in here off fairly easily. And now that I've got the machine off, I meant to say I can get the heat off in here fairly easily. Because you get the window open, and I don't think that there's an air conditioner in this room. And we can get the heat off in here. Now that I've got the machine on, the computer will throw off enough heat that I can turn the heat off. But in here, it's like really, for real. Like, it took like a 35 degree, it took 40 degree humidity to get the heat off in here. Believe it or not. That's how ridiculously stupid the air conditioner upstairs is, right? Anyways, it is finally, and I'm happy about it. I don't know. I know better than to think it'll last, though, right? It'll be short-lived, unfortunately. I got the page wiped down. It didn't take quite as long as I wanted to. Although we've got more shenanigans with my Word document here. It, 1,000 pages seem to disappear. Craziness. They're back here. Who knows where they went, but I got them back. I'm up to 5,400 pages now, if you're keeping track. And I've got all the posts, you know, everything's updated in all the different places. So, I'm gonna get something to eat, and then I'm gonna spend the rest of the night listening carefully. Like I say, everything's done, everything's on, everything's synced up. I've got the posts where I wanted to. I just need to listen to it enough that I can get onto the next phase. And like I say, even what that's about, what that's really about is just getting my ears adjusted, because nothing's gonna actually change, right? So I'm gonna check with the different headphones and the different outs. I kind of wanted to avoid that with this particular record, right? But because I'm still a little funny about the interference and the field patterns and, you know, what the causes of it are, I want to be really sure before I go on to the next part. What I can say with the air conditioner is, because it's so warm in here, I can be certain that the air will be on. right? The air is not going to turn off anytime soon. So at least that's a control, right? So if it's the air conditioning that's fucking with the signal, and you know what? Like my ears are funny. I think the air might even be the reason my ears are popping, right? But I mean, if it's the air conditioner that's fucking with the signal, then at least it's constant, right? So I'll be able to adjust to it. And I didn't pick anything up on the other phones. So, we can do this, you know, we can get back to doing this experiment. I at the very least know how to, deal with it, which is with the tinfoil. But now let's see how I can isolate for it, right? And as I'm going through, isolate for it, figure it out, bring each piece of gear back in. I've been waiting for this for months, but I'm finally here now, and you know, we can finally do this. Okay. That will either take me for the rest of the night, or maybe most of the day tomorrow even. Right now I'm going to get something to eat, because I haven't eaten yet today. Well, I had leftovers from yesterday. I haven't had my today's meal yet, so that's the idea here. Yeah, everything's set up. It's just a question of listening. And I will do that. I'm looking forward to it. And what follows next will be my base gear update. I'm at the end of the vlog here. The machine's on, as I said. I got a little listening in. So, here we go. Here's the base vlog for the 26th. That's the way we'll be doing this. Weekly on Sundays, although we may end up with 2 weeks the first way through. I don't know. We'll find out. So I decided there's not really any way around it. I'm going to need to leave all this stuff out of here one way or another. However, whatever the testing process is, it's going to be very slow. And I'm going to be moving one thing at a time for a long period, so I might as well get all this stuff out of the way, so that I can, live in here a bit. I've got a table up on the side and most of the stuff over there. Bedroom's still a bit of a mess, but that's less of a problem. I can kind of just move that around fairly randomly. But what I've decided I'm going to do, because this is going to take such a long time, and I'm going to be doing one thing at a time. I'm going to do a weekly special on the gear as it moves in. So for each piece of gear that moves its way in, I'll post an update on there. And in 6 months from now, when I've got everything back in, there will be a comprehensive listing of all the gear that I have in here. So this is the base system here. The computer was purchased in early 2007. It's a Pentium D with two 3.6 gigahertz processors. That sounds a little bit more impressive than it is. It gets a little hot. It was at the end of a generation. It was before they started making. Well, it was right at the cusp, like 3.6 is about as fast as you'll find anywhere, but because the technology gets a little bit hotter, it's not as fast as some newer processors that run at, you know, like 2.8 or 3.2 or something like that, right? So, but as far as basic wave speed goes, or wavelength goes, I mean, that's about as fast as has ever been really sold. I mean, not literally, but I mean, you don't really get faster than that, and that's really what I was focusing on here. As a musician, I have slightly different computing requirements than the typical computer nerd, which would be mostly focused around gaming. For example, I don't really care much about the video card. As it happens to be the motherboard that came, I built this machine myself. The motherboard I purchased doesn't have a video out, but I would have got one with a video out if it met my needs. What I was concerned about with the board was primarily its ability for RAM expansion. At the time, the ability to get four slots that could each take 8 gigs of RAM, meaning that this board can take 32, was pretty advanced. It's a P5B. There's only four in there right now because I'm running a 32-bit system. But I mean, even back as far back as 2007, I was always planning on upgrading to a 64-bit system. It didn't happen for a variety of... Well, actually, I was dual-booting a 64-bit version of Vista for a while. And I think I explained this before. I think it's the chipset drivers were just really bad. And I did try it again not that long ago, and they're still... It just takes forever to do copy operations. So this board is really, it's a 32-bit board, despite the fact that it was sold as Vista ready. It'll run, it's just, it doesn't run well. The XP, it's actually very, very, very fast with the processor that's in there and the amount of RAM that it's got. The board has pretty much everything else I might want on it. I've taken just about everything else out. The only other thing on the front here is the live drive, which is actually very old. I got that in, I think, 1999 or 2000. It's a front-end bay. That's a headphone out, that's a line in, it takes a computer, and those are MIDI. And then they've got SPDIFs. When was the last time I saw something with an SPDIF on it? That's a line in there. That was my main sound card for almost 10 years. A large amount, well, pretty much everything. That's not true because all of those remixes, but all of the older material up until 2007 was done with that sound card. It's a great little sound card for what it was when it was. Just the ability to plug a guitar in and play in real time, that was something through a computer in real time, is something that I hadn't had access to before. I think it's still not something that a lot of kids can really do. It's two USBs on the front and a FireWire. That's the case, which itself is kind of fancy there. These are sound connectors that would connect to the board if I was using the integrated sound, which I'm not. It's disabled in the BIOS. The back, I've got it has PS2 connections for the mouse and the keyboard, and I make sure I use them so I'm not wasting the USB. I can never understand, you only get so many USB connections. Why would you waste them on mice and keyboards? Use the PS2 if you got them. That's the FireWire out to the mixer. There's a monitor out with the video card, which is the only card that's in there right now. That will change as I go through and put the different cards in. Beyond that, it's just your basics. There's four USBs there, although it's expandable. I could put two more in through a card. There's two RJ45s. The integrated audio has surround sound, if I decided I wanted to have a gaming system, as well as an SPDIF out on it, and some kind of optical something, as well as an eSATA on it, which, I never used. Besides that, it's an NVIDIA video card. I don't remember the model. I don't really even care, to be honest with you. I purchased the, low battery, just a sec. I'm getting better at the low battery thing, I will conquer this. VGA, actually I purchased that computer with money that, came to me when I moved out. My parents gave me a bit of a chunk of cash when I moved out, which was... it was like $5,000. The computer cost a little more than two, meaning that I still had a bunch left over for emergencies, which was what it was designed for. And I actually paid into that for quite a bit. That sustained me for quite some time. I put the monitor up a little bit later. I can't remember why. I think I had a whole bunch of cathode ray tube monitors. In fact, I think I might still have a couple. I don't know. I can't remember. No, I think they all disappeared. Yeah, that's. I mean, that's a monitor. The mixer. Well, yeah, and I mean the keyboard and the mouse came with the computer. The mixer is. I picked that up when I got laid off from Microsoft in. I guess that would have been late 2007. Yeah. It was picked up on eBay. I think it cost $200. It was cheap. Again, it was in a process of switching generations. It's mostly because it was FireWire, and the FireWire was getting phased out for newer connections and all these other irrelevant things. It's really amazing how far technology can come down for no discernible reason other than marketing on technology kind of thing. I've been using that since for a good while. It didn't. I mean, I wasn't able to use it for a lot of things for a while. Let me rephrase that. I wasn't making a lot of music for a while. Pretty much everything since then has been centered around that as a sound card. It is my main sound card, and will be for the foreseeable future. It's really just your basic 16-track mixer. You can set it up so it records in multiple channels at once into Cubase over the FireWire. It's got all the pots. There's a effects unit in it, but I mean I don't like putting effects on things in real time like that. I'd rather do it on the computer. Different mic-ins, different line-ins, all those kinds of things. Broadly speaking, the main use of having the setup like this is so that I can take things in on the drums, and so that I can split the drums up into different tracks. There was a time when I thought I might actually have some friends over to do some recording. It's been a long time since I had thoughts like that. It did happen at one time that I was thinking along those lines. I'm just checking to see maybe if I might have something at a line here, and it might have, but I mean it's all pretty stable. Yeah, so I mean it's for me the main use of it is just as a high quality sound card. It's useful for that purpose. And I mean the impotence is better when I'm taking things from computer from keyboards and whatnot. Like I say, I use that all the time, but I found there were a lot of situations where it sounded better if I put it through a four-track mixer and sent it on the way in the back. This kind of gets rid of a lot of those problems. Although, something I haven't considered really is the idea of taking that right out. Although, when I'm thinking about it, if it turns out that I'm convinced that I've got an electrical issue here, and it's a ground issue, it might make more sense to try to finish the mix for this project on one of the other cards. It's something I never even really seriously contemplated. I'll work my way down to that. For now, hopefully I can find a way to get this stabilized. Last thing, of course, are the headphones for the basic system. Those headphones, my dad bought those headphones in about, it would have been the late 80s or the early 90s. I think it was the late 80s because I remember playing Atari with those headphones. If you can get your head around how old those headphones are, Atari Yes, like Space Invaders. I'm not that old. The Atari wasn't the contemporary system at the time. It would have been the NES that was the contemporary system, but the Atari was what we had. And so, I'm sitting in the basement, and I would have been like 9 or 10. The truth is that every piece of music that I've ever listened to, that I've ever connected to, has been with those headphones. Like I say, the oldest memories are with them with Atari. As they aged a little bit, they got moved into the living room. I remember using them to watch the X-Files at 2 o'clock in the morning when my parents were sleeping. I remember that would have been what? Would have been before. That would have been in like 95. I was an X-Files fan like right when it started. Like I think I tuned in on the second season. So that would have been like, yeah, like 94, 95. Watching the X-Files with those headphones in my living room. I would have been 13 or 14. And it was like late at night because that's when they were on, was it was reruns at like 2 o'clock in the morning. Then they got moved into the recording space that my dad built for me. Well, I think he really built it for himself. He wanted a drum space. He played a little drums. Big like Phil Collins fan. Actually, I guess maybe something that is more in my lifetime was he was more of a Portnoy fan, big Dream Theater fan. He put a drum kit down there, but because he was an adult that had a full-time job and responsibilities like owning property and talking to bankers about mortgages and all those sorts of things, he didn't really get his drum kit time the way he wanted it to. Rather, I ended up in that room all the time. That's where my earliest demos were done. It was a soundproof room in a basement, and those headphones were down there. I was, I guess, 15 at the time. It was 1996, mid-1996. And I used to, I started taking those headphones on the bus with me to school, listening to them on a cassette Walkman, and then on a CD player, all over the city, all kinds of stuff, everything from early Korn to Nine Inch Nails, Skinny Puppy, all that kind of stuff. And because those are such high-end headphones, they really sounded amazing. Like, all that stuff really sounded amazing through it. Really, probably why I'm such a musical snob. Those headphones probably have a big deal to do with it, because I was able to actually hear the production properly through them. Like I said, they're a pair of Sennheisers from the mid to late 80s. They're 442s. I don't know how much they cost at the time, but if I was to get a, I mean, they're long out of production. They've been out of production for 25 years or something. But if I was to get a comparable pair of Sennheisers like that nowadays, they would be in the $400 to $500 range category. They would be considered studio quality monitor headphones, on the low end of it, certainly, but nonetheless. I mentioned before that my dad was an audiophile, so he got them to listen to his progressive rock, but like I say, I ended up listening to them. And when I was a kid, I had no idea. To me, they were just awesome headphones. Like putting a price tag on it or anything like that didn't. When even as a teenager, you just don't think like that. You just think awesome phones. I'm going to use them as much as I can. So they followed me around everywhere, in the recording studio, on the bus. I couldn't listen to them in class. They're kind of big. But certainly, anytime I was out and about, those phones were with me. And anytime I was at home, the phones were with me. I didn't play many video games after I turned about 15 or 16, largely because most of my time was spent You know, with music related things, but the one game I did kind of get into was Civ 2, and I certainly have a lot of memories with those phones. You know, listening to actually the one record I really remember listening to was Pop by U2. I mean, it would have been 97 or 98, and playing Civ 2 for hours. They followed me, you know, into the recording studio when I set that up. You know, or more as the studio increased in complexity, the phones remained static. And here they are still today, you know, what is it, 20 years later. You know, I have every reason to think they're still functioning properly, but certainly when I talk about, yeah, you know, are the phones picking up interference? Did I damage something in them? They are very old phones, and they've been through hell. They've been through snowstorms. They've sat in the back of my knapsack all day. They've been in storage and, you know, in garages. They've been through hell, and they still work. But you know, there will come a day, one day, where I will need to get new headphones, and the world will sound different. Everything will sound different because everything I've ever listened to has been through those phones. But that's my base system: computer, mixer, monitor, phones. It's gonna have to stay like this for a while. All I'm gonna be swapping out for the next day or two is gonna be the power cables, you know, the outlets, that kind of thing, to ensure that I'm stable. And if I'm not, it's going to be like contacting the electrical company to try to get them to fix the wire, the cables outside, or something like that. But I mean, I'm not going to start moving things back in until I'm sure that it's stable in here, and I'm not getting any interference. And when I do, it'll be one at a time. So, slowly but surely, at least I can say I don't have. Well, I mean, I've had this vlog for close to 2 months now, and you haven't even seen me pick up a guitar. It's distressing. How can this be? I haven't done anything except, you know, like, I mean, but I mean, even as that is, what I've got up ahead of me is mixing and filing. It's going to be a bit before I get anything back into an order that I can actually play it. But it is coming soon. Believe me, I want to get back to work. So that's it's just, I mean, I'm not really in a particular hurry. I don't need to be in a particular hurry to get anything reconstructed here. It's just a it's just a persistent driving feeling of wanting to, rather than any actual, you know, real necessity to. So yeah, I actually like the idea that this little segment's coming up, because I've got a lot of gear, and it'll be fun to run through the stories for each little piece of it.